player of all time, Wayne Krubet.
Number 10.
Wayne Krubet has to be the definitive undrafted success story in the NFL.
In 1995, this future Jet great was ignored by every NFL team.
You just wonder how he slipped through the cracks.
He was too small to be a football player in the eyes of anyone who looked at him.
He is not particularly fast. His little feet just move incredibly quickly.
Maybe didn't run a 40 in the proper time or bench press enough weight. All the silly little drills that they make him do, all he can do is play football.
What a catch by Wayne Krubet.
He was a possession guy. I mean, he wasn't going to stretch the field, but he was a guy who could make plays on third down, move the chain.
That's the go-to guy on third down.
If you actually took the time to watch him, you'd see that, wow, he was good.
Touchdown!
Wayne Krubet, I think Hofstra, and then I think White.
Wayne Krubet showing some great hands.
Which means you go undrafted.
A tough kid who can catch in a crowd.
By the time our number 10 undrafted player graduated, he owned several Hofstra receiving records, including a 5-touchdown game that tied the collegiate record held by Jerry Rice. Still, most teams were apprehensive. So who was the bold genius who took a chance?
I did. We got into training camp. I keep seeing this kid diving, making great plays, and it was Wayne Krubet.
I won't be happy, you know, leaving here. I don't want to leave here. I didn't get myself a round-trip token for the bridge because I don't plan on going home.
You want Ryan around the corner? You want the...
Let Krubet!
Let the kid run it.
Okay.
Get Krubet in there. Get in there. I got to give this kid some experience. He's a tough son. Oh, he's great. He can do a lot of things.
We had a meeting. I says, I want to start this kid. And the guys are saying, well, I says, we're going to start him.
I love Wayne. He's one of my all-time favorite Jets, without a doubt. He certainly belongs in the top 10.
Krubet was an underdog that as a Jet fan you could wrap your arms around. I think that's why Krubet was as loved as he was, because he was every man.
New York's working-class hero achieved stardom when he became the first undrafted player to have his own cereal.
I would imagine Krubet Crunch gets soggy in milk just like everything else. If you think about it, Krubet was a captain of the Jets at one point. So in a way, that was Captain Crunch.
Well, he wears number 9. When he wins a Super Bowl, you can move him up to number 1.
I don't know if he really deserves to be on this list.
There's the snap, the spot. Romo can't get the spot down!
He has his flaws, he has his faults, but for a guy who's not drafted, he's done real well.
The playoff drought is over. This is not a monkey that the Cowboys have gotten off their back. This is King Flippin' Kong.
Let's hold off on putting Tony Romo on any all-time list unless it's all-time greatest girlfriends list.
I think you'd have to put Romo a little higher than 9. He's been with a couple tens.
He's dated Carrie Underwood, Jessica Simpson, and the guy has achieved the American dream in my eyes.
Sort of conquered that. You know, much respect, Tony. Way to go.
Until he does something bigger than that, I don't even want to talk about him.
Maybe he doesn't want a Super Bowl, but would you trade spots with him? Probably you would.
Tony Romo is an amazing story because this is a guy who shouldn't be a starting quarterback in the NFL.
Here's a guy from Eastern Illinois. I thought guys like that just by law could not play in the NFL.
The 414 yards passing would be Tony Romo's career high for a single game.
In 2002, Romo was named the top player in Division I AA, but many felt his skills weren't a good fit for pro football.
Tony Romo came from a small school. Granted, he was very good, but he's a shorter quarterback. He does not have a big arm, doesn't play the position with a lot of precision and discipline. They probably saw all those traits and didn't see him as a draftable player.
He was invited to the combine as a thrower. He wasn't even brought in as a quarterback prospect. He was brought in to throw to the wide receivers.
Our number 9 undrafted player caught a break when a couple of Eastern Illinois alums offered him a free agent contract.
Sean Payton saw a lot of himself in Tony Romo, and therefore he was attracted to that style of quarterback.
Payton sold him to Parcells, and the Cowboys signed him as a free agent.
I offered him $20,000, and he actually went with Sean Payton for $10,000. And when I saw Tony one day, I said, I can't even get you for $10,000 more. And he said, well, you had Berline as a backup. And he said, I knew I had a better chance to make Dallas' team than your team. So at least he saved my ego a little bit.
Lights ever go on, we might have something there, boys.
By 2006, Romo was the number two quarterback on the Cowboys' depth chart.
Drew Bledsoe, at some point, he's going to pull the gun out and point it in the wrong direction and take it to himself.
He underthrew it and is intercepted. I'm sure there are a lot of these fans saying they need to make a change.
He got a chance and took advantage of it wildly.
His ability to move around is the Romo magic.
How long do you think the Cowboys had to work on that? Oh, merciful heavens, what a throw and catch that is.
Now! You kidding me? You love it? Come on, let's go!
When you think of the top 10 undrafted players of all time, anybody come to mind immediately?
Immediately, Rod Smith comes to mind.
He's a great example to show what it takes to get to the NFL and what it takes to stay in the NFL.
Rod Smith starred as a wide receiver and part-time quarterback at Missouri Southern State. He graduated in 1994 with school records in receptions, yards, and touchdowns.
Matt Cook's pass complete to Rod Smith for the Lions touchdown.
I was All-American my junior year. Scouts would come through, and then I got hurt my first senior year, and then they never came back.
He's not very big. He's faster than people thought, but he didn't light up the stopwatch.
I didn't go to the combine. I didn't go to any of the Senior Bowls. And these are things that I was told I would get to do.
I'm not really sure why he wasn't drafted.
If you ever want to know it's not an exact science, you can look at that.
Sometimes all you need is somebody to believe in you. Rod got Wade Phillips to believe in him.
It's time to get ready now.
He spent his first year on the practice squad.
I was excited, man. I was happy. I was happy I had a job. I did everything everybody else did except I didn't play on Sundays.
And then Mike came in and gave an opportunity to play.
But I was sure happy when I came to Denver as a head coach that he was on the practice team because it didn't take long to figure out he was going to be a stud in the National Football League.
Ross. First NFL catch was a game-winner Hail Mary on Darrell Green.
Here goes the pass. Rod Smith up. He got it. Rod goes to win.
I got put in at position by default. Everybody else had gotten knocked out. Eddie Mack, he knocked out. Anthony Miller was out. Mike Pritchard was out.
The weapons are slowly slipping away for the Broncos.
He has said of all the catches he's had, number one is still his favorite highlight.
Unbelievable. What a catch. Rod Smith forced into the game with injuries with a miracle.
I actually cut two first-round draft choices after my first year, knowing that we would go with Rod Smith. And you don't do that as a head coach in your second year unless you get a lot of confidence in somebody.
Let's go, baby. Here we go. Big things today, baby. Big things today.
Smith's first catch may have been special, but it's just as much his next 848 that earned him a spot on our list.
Rod Smith, Denver touchdown.
Rod had the typical traits of someone who was undrafted who wanted to prove themselves.
These are all-time leading receiver in receptions, touchdowns, and yards. And also, he's the all-time leader in all those categories among undrafted free agent receivers.
Rod Smith needs one catch for 100. Yes.
Rod was sort of the go-to guy whenever, you know, John needed help. That's who he was looking for.
John lost one down the left sideline. Rod Smith, touchdown!
Yeah!
I've heard this from a few people, and I don't know how true it is. They say, once I catch the ball, I've never seen anybody turn up field as fast as you.
They bring six. Elway dumps it, and here goes Rod Smith. 30, 20. You can forget it. Touchdown, Denver.
Some receivers do a better job of avoiding hits than others, and he was smart about it.
It's tough to get a chance if you're undrafted. Rod Smith did and made the most of it. I think he's headed for the Hall of Fame.
To NFL scouts out there, you guys actually get paid for this, right? He's 6 foot, he's 200 pounds, great hands, great work ethic. How did you miss this guy again?
Antonio Gates went undrafted because he was a college basketball player.
He was a very good basketball player. He was one of the best players in the Mid-American Conference, Kent State.
It's a big second quarter for Gates.
Played in the Elite Eight.
Mr. March Madness.
Antonio Gates is funny.
He comes into the NFL, and he's a Pro Bowl player right off the start.
Not bad for a guy that wasn't drafted, huh?
That's just incredible. Antonio Gates definitely deserves to be in the top 10.
Our number number 7 undrafted player was recruited by Michigan State to play both football and basketball. But when Spartans coach Nick Saban wanted him to only play football, Gates transferred to Kent State.
He just told me about, you know, natural abilities that I had in football. And I just always wanted to play basketball. I just grew up wanting to play basketball.
Turns out Saban was right. Gates was too small to be drafted by the NBA. So our number 7 undrafted player called on his high school football experience and gave the NFL a shot.
Believe it or not, he hardly had anyone show up to his workout.
It was the first time he'd had a football helmet on in 5 years.
How in the world did the Chargers know this guy would be this good?
If we had any idea that, you know, he was going to be as good as he was, we would have drafted him probably in the first round rather than, you know, having him signed as a free agent.
Antonio Gates is in there yet again.
Now he's arguably one of the best tight ends of the last 25 years. I don't understand it. I mean, that tells you how scouting is. Not very good.
It's just amazing that they basically overlooked him, I'm sure, because he played basketball and people just didn't think of him in that way. But somebody should have known.
The same traits that made Antonio Gates the most valuable player in the MAC conference at Kent State allowed him to be an excellent tight end.
Oh, the big hoopster from Kent State, climbing high for the rebound.
Watch, everybody you talk to will say, he plays football like a basketball player.
That's like a big guy in the low post getting a rebound.
Basketball.
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 Basketball skills.
Imagine how good Antonio Gates would have been if he played basketball at something other than a MAC school.
Touchdown, San Diego!
He has that explosion that I've never seen, a guy that size. The body control, obviously the soft hands.
Gates will throw, boy, just a great job.
Nice get. One-on-one. That he really only runs about 4 or 5 routes. That's it. But nobody seems to be able to catch him.
Is there anybody on this planet that could cover Antonio Gates?
Since entering the league in 2003, Gates has been unstoppable. Our number 7 undrafted player has 2 1,000-yard seasons, has averaged 8 touchdowns per year, and has been selected to the Pro Bowl 6 times.
Antonio Gates has 4 of the top 10 tight end seasons since 1993.
Not bad for a guy that wasn't drafted, huh?
With all of these guys, all the other scouts missed, yeah, why does an NFL team just send guys to the NCAA tournament versus the combine? They could do better.
Number 6 undrafted player of all time, Warren Moon.
He was drafted, wasn't he?
Warren Moon wasn't drafted?
Nope.
Wow.
It really is a joke that he wasn't drafted.
He was pretty much screwed.
To think that he was passed over back in the days when there were a lot of rounds in the draft, it's pretty amazing.
Who were the guys that said he wasn't good enough to play in the NFL? We should line those people up and throw tomatoes at him.
Can you imagine? Warren Moon might have gone out and sold insurance, or taught school, or started a business, all worthwhile careers, but this is a Hall of Fame quarterback that nobody wanted.
Back then, you know, black quarterbacks didn't get a shot in the NFL.
Prototypical size, cannon arm, threw for 1 million yards in college.
The Huskies can also move the football in the air with senior quarterback Warren Moon.
But his skin tone's a little bit too dark. He can't play quarterback for us. How absurd is this?
Well, what I was told was that I didn't have the arm strength, that I was too short, and that I didn't come out of a pro-style offense.
Warren Moon was a pro-style passer even at Hamilton High School. Certainly at the University of Washington, led them to the Rose Bowl.
They're going to back off and rush forward as Moon fires the ball. Touchdown! Yes, sir!
Warren Moon at Washington moved around a lot, threw the ball on the run. In 1978, that was not seen as necessary to play quarterback in the NFL.
He had mobile, agile quarterback. He obviously can't think.
By all rights, in the modern era, Warren Moon would have probably gone number 1 overall.
And I respect the fact that Warren Moon said, yes, I am a quarterback. If you won't give me a shot, I'll go somewhere where I will get a shot.
And he had to go up to Canada to prove himself. He went to Canada, was beyond prolific.
Moon, he steps up and fires. Tom Scott is wide open. Touchdown. The number 6 undrafted player of all time shocked everyone when he led the Edmonton Eskimos to 5 straight Grey Cup titles.
You know, he might be able to play a little bit.
He made the NFL sit up and take notice. I'm a quarterback. Give me a shot.
In 1984, Moon signed as a free agent with the Houston Oilers.
Houston actually paid him the biggest contract in history, $5.5 million. Not bad for a guy that was never drafted.
Yeah, he had already proven himself, but he had to get it done in the NFL, and he did.
From the very beginning, Moon was able to confirm that his reputation wasn't made up, dreamed up, or overblown.
Over a 17-year career, our number six undrafted player proved he could do everything the experts said he couldn't.
A classic leader.
Hello! Let's take one down, all right? Let's put one all together and let's take one down.
Wow, could he throw the football?
The way it comes through behind the ear. I mean, it's the tightest spiral you can see.
Warren Moon is putting on a clinic here today.
There's a guy who threw for 35 miles.
And Warren Moon has been so sharp on that deep pass today, it's almost scary.
Warren Moon is one of the guys who goes way beyond statistics. Warren Moon erased the terminology black quarterback from the game.
We're talking about the first black quarterback to get into the Hall of Fame.
I only played this game not for just myself, not for just my teammates. I had a responsibility to play the game for my people.
How do you miss this? I mean, all this guy does is, you know, drill field goals in the toughest circumstances possible.
The Patriots are Super Bowl champions!
You look back on it now and you say, were these guys all blind? How could they not see what he was?
Before Vinatieri earned renown for his NFL heroics, he kicked collegiately at South Dakota State, graduating in 1995 as the school's all-time leading scorer. But that wasn't enough to open NFL up.
A 51-yard field goal by Adam Vinatieri.
Well, you know, in Adam's case, South Dakota's a long ways away.
Didn't get invited to a camp, so I moved to Virginia. Started working with a kicking coach down there. Was drafted by the Amsterdam Admirals.
Line up and kick it. Nice, easy stroke.
Vinatieri, 43-yard attempt. Got it!
Vinatieri picked his way to a job in New England, where he developed a lasting reputation.
He is the greatest pressure kicker I have ever seen.
Kick is up, and it is good! Adam Vinatieri puts the Patriots up.
He didn't do it once, he didn't do it twice, he didn't do it three times, he just kept doing it every time he got there.
And it is right between the sticks.
The best play I've ever seen was the kick that he had in the snow.
Snap, ball down, kick up on the way, and it is good!
Vinatieri went 2 for 2 with Super Bowl titles hanging in the balance.
The kick from 48 yards was absolutely positively right down the middle.
Kick is on the way, and it is good! It's good! It's good!
When you made the 48-yard kick to win the first of the Patriots' 3 Super Bowls, you know, you're on the edge of the seat. When he made the 41-yard, it was like a gimme putt.
Adam Vinatieri with the money on the table bangs it through.
I don't believe that Adam Vinatieri becoming an Indianapolis Colt is coincidental to the Colts winning a championship.
He had a game against the Baltimore Ravens they would have otherwise lost. He made every single point for that team that day.
Adam Vinatieri, 5 for 5 today.
He not only delivered the Patriots in 3 Super Bowls, his kicks were the winning margin, but he saved them and earned them a Super Bowl. It's really 4 Super Bowls the guy's responsible for.
I'm sure he's missed one in that situation. I can't remember which one.
9 seconds left. Patriots try to win it. Kick is up, and it is no good!
He didn't make all of them. He made some of the most dramatic ones, but he also missed some very makeable kicks.
Let's call it 29 yards.
He gets ready. The snap, the ball is down, the kick is on its way. It's good!
Come on. It's good!
Oh, it's good! No, wait a minute, he said no good! No good, he missed it.
Very good player, yes. Good clutch kicker, yeah. All-time great clutch performer, no.
You look at it and you say, I'm going to go to South Dakota and draft a kicker.
Why would you draft one? You can always get one.
To send the Jets to the AFC Championship game.
It's no good!
You'd have given up whatever it took to get Adam to be your kicker at that time.
There are certain guys who feel kickers aren't football players.
Kickers are not players. They're necessities.
He was caught by the kicker. Adam Vinatieri runs Herschel Walker down.
His exploits earned him a spot on our list and may eventually earn Vinatieri a spot in an even more exclusive club.
I'd say he's going to the Hall of Fame for all the clutch kicks he's made.
I think that he will be the second kicker ever inducted.
If he's not in the Hall of Fame, they should lock the doors of the Hall of Fame.
When you look at what Vinatieri's done,
what he's accomplished.
Patriots win.
How did somebody not take a chance on him coming out of college?
Number 4 undrafted player of all time, Marion Motley.
Marion Motley. Wow, he was undrafted? Number 4? I didn't know that. Really?
Fullback Marion Motley wore both 76 and 36 for the Cleveland Browns in the 40s and 50s, and he did a real number on opposing defenses.
One of the first great, really big backs.
Huge, gigantic, almost inhuman, as big as he was.
At 240 pounds, he was a force of nature who gave defenders the grim choice of being buried or blasted.
I think of a transformer, robotic figure, just pounding his way through.
And a guy like that was a tremendous weapon. Back then, you'd have defensive ends who'd weigh 200 pounds. You'd have linebackers who'd weigh 210. Safety men would be 180 pounds. How do you tackle him?
He was the kid in the Sandlot game that was 3 times bigger than everyone else, and you just gave him the ball and let him run.
Almost like the Jerome Bettis of the 1940s.
The bus is rolling. The bus is hitting on all cylinders.
I knock your brains out and then pick them up later.
Marion Motley belongs on this list, if for no other reason, his place in history.
Motley was not chosen in a 30-round draft for one reason. In 1946, pro football had no black players until Cleveland coach Paul Brown signed the Ohio native to a free agent contract.
It probably would have drawn too much attention to do it through the draft.
Basically, they broke what had been a color barrier in pro football.
And this was a year before Jackie Robinson went to the Brooklyn Dodgers.
When you think about Motley and you say, what does it take for a player to break that color line at that time in our nation's history, you've got to give him even more credit for his greatness.
With a jet start, Motley was past the line in a flash.
You can imagine what it was like for Marion Motley, knowing the other teams can take a shot at you, knowing that you're going to get hit on every play.
They didn't call the unnecessary roughness penalties like they do today.
He said that he never fought back, he never talked back. He said, I always got my revenge on the next play. He had so many great runs, so many touchdowns, he got his revenge.
The thing with a lot of these players is, you know, could they play today?
Oh my! This is the type of player teams in this league dream about finding to put at running back.
Marion Motley could have played in any year. The guy was 260 pounds, and he had speed.
Marion Motley had quite an afternoon busting through the tremendous Yankee line.
Here's another one of those examples of players in the league that we forget because so few people are now around anymore to remember how great a player Marion Motley was.
I'm glad that he's on this list and we haven't forgotten Marion Motley.
Somebody must have really messed up.
He might be the best interior pass rusher in the history of the National Football League.
Pump fake, looking right, looking left. Sacked at the 8-yard line.
He was the quintessential undrafted talent for me. High motor, never took a playoff. I thought he was the greatest defensive tackle of this era.
He did not make the combine. No one thought he could play.
No way, man, no way. I worked too hard.
In 1990, John Randall signed with the Vikings as an undrafted free agent. Scouts said the Texas A&I product was too small for the NFL.
Hey, you got better?
I hope he's not.
I'm not short.
I'm tall, man. Look at him tall that legs.
We saw a guy who played like he was 6'5 or 6.
6'6, man. I'm 6'6.
And played like he was 320.
Set your big ass down.
Forget about what the stat sheet said.
He was a very disruptive player.
Craig is back to pass, pressured by Randall, tipped up, picked off, intercepted.
And he was really, really quick and really difficult to block.
And who would you guess would be in the middle of it? Johnny Randall. Double sack by Randall. Great play, John Randall.
What he lacked in size, Randall made up for with sacks.
Here's a guy that had 138, I believe, sacks as a defensive tackle, not as a defensive end.
Hey, that don't leave a mark.
History will never really give it its full due.
Sometimes those guys who are an inch short and 20 pounds light, they make up for it by having a gigantic chip on their shoulder.
Pass to Randall, the sack!
Everyone needs like an enemy and, you know, a nemesis. Being undrafted was his, so he took it out on everybody.
Put my 40th python over your ass.
I think John Randall is the most underrated player to ever play a game of football. I can say that because I go against him twice a year.
Here's Favre back and Randall sacks.
You talk to the guys who played against John Randall, and they thought he was more of a handful week in, week out, every Sunday than just about any defensive lineman in a game.
Well, I tell you what, there's no way you're going to go into a game and say, okay, we ain't going to worry about John Randall.
I'm glad that for whatever reason, I never had to play against his relentlessness, his passion, the type of relentlessness and passion you can only get if you're a hungry, undrafted player.
He was a volcanic NFL player.
Oh, my.
Blow it up! Blow it up!
Of all the players I've shot over 35 years of working for NFL Films, John Randall is by far the most interesting. And I can't think of a close second.
Night Rider! Night Rider!
For all the talking he did.
Big dogs are in the house!
For all the trash talking.
Regulator! Mount up! We're coming!
For all the great NFL film he provided with his mouth.
But I'm telling you, me and you should hang out. We should go fishing together.
Guy could really play.
He revolutionized the position. He was the first big physical corner. Offenses feared him.
Look out, Daniel! Oh, doctor!
Baddest man on the planet.
Night Train just says it all.
The pass is good, but bang!
The play is diagnosed perfectly by Night Train Lane.
Night Train had the ability to do the bait and switch. He would play off, the opposing quarterback would look and see, oh, geez, the guy's uncovered. And at that moment, Night Train would break for the ball. That's why he got so many interceptions.
Johnny Unitas and the Colts try to come from behind, but Dick Night Train Lane derails the attempt.
In my book, the greatest defensive back that ever played the game.
Abandoned in a dumpster as a baby, our number two undrafted player overcame long odds, both in life and in his quest to be part of the NFL.
Now, he went to Scottsbluff Junior College in Nebraska.
I mean, you don't draft guys out of the junior colleges.
He only spent 1 year in college, and then he goes into the Army.
He's discharged from the Army, goes back to Los Angeles, and gets a job at an aircraft factory, and he hates it.
He just got frustrated and said, you know, I think I can play football. Found the Rams office, walked in and asked for a tryout, bringing his scrapbook, and showed him what he did, and they agreed to let him have a tryout.
In today's NFL, that's unthinkable. But in the NFL of 1952, somebody would give you a tryout. He tells them he's a receiver. The coach, Joe Stidahar, looks at Night Train, who's 6'2", 195 pounds, and says, you look more like a defensive player to me. Puts him on defense, which Train had really never played before. Goes on a practice field. Deacon Dan Towler, who was the Rams' number one running back, tries to go around the end, and Night Train comes up and levels him. And everything on the practice field stops, and Joe Stidahar says, that's my kind of football player. He won the job. And then in that season, in a 12-game regular season, he intercepts 14 passes to set an NFL record that still stands today.
Yet another of our undrafted players who was involved with a famous singer.
Donna Washington was a great jazz and blues singer of the time.
Night Train, I believe, was his third marriage, and I think it was her seventh. So it wasn't necessarily a marriage made in heaven.
Wilt Chamberlain actually was the best man in their wedding. Nowadays, everybody talks about Tony Romo and whoever he's dating. But Night Train Lane and Diana were definitely a pretty famous couple.
I remember those years when he was married to Diana Washington. Tell you what, our team parties, they charge a lot of money to get into them today.
After our number two undrafted player retired, he worked for comedian Red Fox and then the Detroit Police Athletic League mentoring disadvantaged children, never forgetting his humble beginnings.
Night Train Lane is an amazing story. It's like something out of a fairy tale.
And now, the number one undrafted player of all time, Kurt Warner.
Number one.
The greatest grocery bagger in NFL history.
Obviously, when Kurt Warner puts his body of work together, at the end of it, you look at it and you go, what were you people thinking? How could you miss on this? But he went to Northern Iowa.
Warner received Conference Player of the Year honors in his 1 year as a starter, but received nothing more from the NFL than a free agent invitation to Packers camp in 1994.
Anybody you talk to who was with the Packers when he first got there, he wasn't good enough to play.
So he didn't get a very good chance.
He goes off to make $6 an hour at the Hy-Vee grocery store.
I mean, what's a quarterback who, you know, who can't stock a shelf?
Warner got his first taste of professional football in the Arena League.
Led by first-team All-Arena quarterback Kurt Warner, the Iowa club rides a 10-game winning streak.
Our number one undrafted player parlayed his arena career into a job in NFL Europe. But success in Amsterdam didn't particularly excite people in the U.S.
He wasn't big and strong as Elway. He didn't have the arm that Marino had. He didn't have the speed that I had. So he can't be good enough, right? But he can play.
Throws the end zone. Touchdown, Rams!
He doesn't look too bad.
Quarterback? No, he looks pretty good.
He goes from Scout Team Player of the Year in 1998 to the NFL Player of the Year in 1999.
You've done quite a job, man.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
No, quite a job.
For that chance.
Well, hey, you got it, and you've done the most with it.
Next thing you know, at the end of the season, Kurt Warner is holding up the Super Bowl MVP award.
Touchdown, Rams!
Congratulations on being the MVP in the Super Bowl. Kurt Warner.
He has that year, the single greatest year that a quarterback has ever had.
It was the finest single-year performance in the history of the National Football League.
But it takes more than one good season to earn the top spot on our list.
One of the most amazing things about Kurt Warner is he got to the top of the mountain, he fell off the cliff, and he didn't give up.
People have written him off over and over.
Never more so than during Warner's one frustrating season with the Giants.
I don't know what he was thinking. He had to know we were going to blitz him. I'm so stupid.
And I remember one of the New York guys saying, well, you know, he can't make the throws.
Deep over the middle, looking for Shockey. The pass is deflected. Intercepted by Azuma.
So he ends up in Arizona. Everybody thought he was done.
Doing what he was able to do in Arizona, being able to lift that franchise up out of where it was nothing short of amazing.
Fitz is there. He caught it at the 10. Touchdown!
He may as well have taken Slippery Rock College to the Super Bowl because they weren't going to get there either.
When nobody else believed in us, when nobody else believed in me,
you're all so quarterbacks, quarterbacks, quarterbacks. I would have John Randall ahead of Kurt Warner. There was no donut hole in the middle of John Randall's career.
So should the valleys of Warner's career have caused him to drop on our list?
It's like he's really only had half a career, and the other half he's kind of either been a bum or a backup or injured.
He had the last years where he couldn't even take a snap without the ball landed on the ground.
Warner again fumbles the snap. It's loose.
Anybody who worked at the grocery store and went on to be a two-time MVP.
Touchdown.
We ain't done yet. We ain't done yet.
And Super Bowls with two different teams.
Quarterback from Northern Iowa, number 13, Kurt Warner.
That has to be number one.
When you come out of Nowhere University and play in Nowhere Arena Bowl and play in Nowhere Europe and you're stocking shelves in a grocery store, yeah, I think on story alone, that one deserves to be at the top of the list.